I know people going out. My request you to stay in the hall. We'll be starting the most prestigious event of this conference, that is Professor M.J. Joshi oration. Now I will start the proceedings for the oration. I request the president of the Indian IHPBA, Dr. G.V. Rao, to come on the dais. I request Dr. T.D. Yadav, secretary of Indian chapter of IHPBA, to come on the dais. And Dr. Shailesh Srikhande, president-elect of the association, to come on the dais. I also request Dr. Oscar, he is not in the auditorium, maybe he join us later. I request our secretary, Dr. T.D. Yadav, to kindly introduce Professor M.J. Joshi oration. Dr. T.D. Yadav, please.
Thanks, Dr. Mahesh. Namaskar. Very good morning, Suprabhatam. As a secretary of IHPB India, I have been assigned this duty to introduce Professor, late Professor Manohar Joshi, a surgeon and academician. Dr. Manohar Joshi, fondly remembered by all his students as MJ, was born in Ratnagiri in a family of social reformers, and his parents, late Sri J.B. Elias Babu Rao and Malti Bai Joshi, were the first to start a school for the girls in the entire Konkan in 1925, and which has now grown into the big institution in the name of Ratnagiri Education Society. Dr. Joshi passed his matriculation from Ratnagiri by standing first in the Konkan region and was admitted to SETS GS Medical College, Mumbai, for his undergraduate studies. He did his MS under the guidance of a very famous surgeon, Professor A.K. Baliga. Later, he went to Royal College of Surgeons of England to obtain a FRCS and returned back home to serve his country. He then got married to Mohini, daughter of then Union Minister Health, late Sri D.P. Karmakar. On his arrival to India, he joined BJ Medical College and Sassoon General Hospital in Pune as honorary associate professor of surgery, and he started a three-bedded hospital in Jalgin Maharaj Road. Unfortunately, it got completely washed out in 1961 by the floods, but this young man sustained the trauma and kept his courage intact. He was emeritus professor to surgery, BJ Medical College and Sassoon Hospital, Pune. His work on the uncinate process of pancreas received worldwide acclaim. He performed more than 200 cadaveric dissections. He had large series of the successful Whipple's pancreatic duodenectomy to his credit in the era when the divide of sophisticated energy sources and intensive care management the way we have today. He also had the large series of the surgery for chronic pancreatitis and stressed upon the importance of draining the head of the pancreas, as we call it, coring today. He mastered the art of pancreatic surgery and was invited to give orations in various national international conferences all over the world. His research book on the surgical diseases of the tropics has been a popular book for the postgraduate study. Dr. Joshi has presided over many national and international organizations, and he had served as a dean of faculty of medicine, University of Pune, and a member executive committee of the Medical Council of India. He has been president of the Association of Surgeons of India, Indian Society of Gastroenterology, International College of Surgeons, Indian Section, Indian Society of HPB Surgery, and World Congress of Digestive Surgery. He was founder of the Maharashtra State Chapter of ASI and Pune Surgical Society. He has received many prestigious awards around the world. Professor M. Joshi has a dream of developing an institute of gastroenterology. many of his students have joined hands to make his dream true in the form of Dr. Manohar Joshi Memorial Hospital, MJM Hospital in Pune. I am proud privileged to introduce Professor Joshi and thank IHPB India, and the IHPB India is privileged to honor bestowed upon this, endorse this prestigious award to our Professor Avinash Supe, who has contributed so much to the Indian chapter of IHPBA. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. T.D. Yadav, for introducing the oration. Now I request Dr. Vidyachandra Gandhi to escort Dr. N. Supe to the dais. Now I call upon Dr. Suryaban Balerao, the organizing secretary of this conference, to come on the dais and introduce the orator.
Good morning, everybody. Professor Avinash Supe is popularly known to us as Avinash to most of the people sitting in the audience. He is eminent teacher, professor of surgery, dean, KM Hospital and St. G.S. Medical College, Bombay. I'll request Dr. Professor Avinash Supe to start M.J. Joshi oration. Dr. M.J. Joshi was one of a comprehensive teacher to us during our undergraduate as well as postgraduate days. Thank you. Avinash.
I think respected chairman, all the organizers, I'm really honored and humbled to be here to give this oration. Dr. Manohar Joshi, I must tell you, was a GSite. He was from a strong GSite, same college as I come from. He was an emeritus professor of surgery, but he was the founder of Maharashtra State of Chapter of ASI and Pune Surgical Society, and he was president of Association of Surgeons, IHG, International College of Surgeons, and IHPBA Indian Section. The most important part all of us remember of him, he organized 1990 World Congress. That was the first time when everybody saw GI surgery. And also he published a book on surgical diseases in tropics, which all of us really used for many years, because that was the only book from India regarding the tropical diseases. He had worked on areas of pancreas much before anybody could really dare to touch. And I think he was really sincere, a really great organizer, and he was a mentor for all of us. Now, what I'm going to really talk today, the theme of my topic is transformation going beyond change. And I'm going to walk through the journey, what all of us have gone through over the last few years, probably my generation, who have gone through this HPB surgery as a specialty. Now, if you really go through, there are three eras of this HPB surgery. One is pre-IHPB era, prior to 2001. Second is IHPB era over the last 18 years, how we have really progressed. And then what is the impact? And how do we really go ahead now? What are the challenges which we are going to really face in the next few years? So if you really look through before IHPBA, sometime in 70s and 80s, you look at this statement from 1977, 20% patient died on the table, 14% died post-operatively, and 15% died because of the liver failure. That was a situation where everybody was really struggling. And if you look at the results of even operations like trisegmentectomy and lobectomy, there was a fairly good amount of operative mortality from one of the best centers in the world. Now, in 70s and 80s, what was the Indian scene? I'm sure Dr. Balerao, our own teacher, did the first liver transplant. There were a lot of people like Dr. Rangabasham, Dr. Nandi, Dr. B.M.L. Kapoor, Dr. Khanduri, I'm sure I may take few names. If I don't take names, don't feel that I may have just missed them. But these are the people who really started doing liver surgery, HPV surgery in India at that time. It was sporadic. The diagnostic was not so good. There was not even an ultrasound. And the equipment was not there. Significant morbidity and mortality up to 30%, and this is from Dr. Rangabasham's paper. But we must appreciate their courage and enthusiasm, the way really they really took that challenge in those days. Having said that, the pancreatic surgery that time was mainly done in the southern states, and it was mainly for the surgery for chronic pancreatitis. The concepts of acute pancreatitis were very hazy. There was no CT, no ultrasound. Vipals performed at very few places in India. I think in that was a time, sometime in 70s, Dr. Manohar Joshi, Dr. Bapat, Dr. Shrikhande, who is sitting here, they were the pioneers in this surgery in that time. The portal hypertension was that time the main, because the bleeding was still the major surgical problem. Shunts were commonly done in pre-endoscopy and sclerotherapy area. Devascularization procedures were done. Portal venous anatomy was done by those splenoportograms. And there were select centers with high morbidity or some morbidity. Dr. Bhale Rao, Dr. Mathur, I worked extensively with Dr. Mathur with portal hypertension and tremendous contribution to the HPV surgery in Western India. Dr. Nandi was a pioneer in doing all kinds of shunts, and even Dr. Piyush. Many of these centers really contributed immensely to the development of portal hypertension surgery. I remember a day in 1985, Indian Society of Gastroenterology meeting in Chennai. There were about 15 or 20 senior surgeons. All of the surgeons were there, Dr. Rangabasham, Dr. Joshi, Dr. Mathur, and all of them sat behind next to that hotel and discussing about that surgeons don't get that much of exposure, neither surgeons are discussed anymore. I was a lecturer at that time. And they decided, yes, we need to have a separate society. And that was the reason why the first conference of Indian Association of Surgical Gastroenterology came. And that was in 1988. And this was a time the surgery was really expanding into different kind of subspecialities. I must bring to your notice one editorial which was written in HPV surgery 1994. And the dilemma was HPV surgery an independent specialty or a branch of digestive surgery. And this dilemma continued sometime in 90s. The Sting Bengbach wrote a first editorial for HPB, and he said that it is completely changing. There are alternative techniques. Cooperation between different specialties and specialists is an extreme importance, and therefore HPB surgery is now being established around the world. People were skeptical whether this will stand, whether even ISG will stand. People were all questioning all that kind of a thing. I had that time an opportunity to work with Professor Blumgart. It was really a privilege to work with that man, one-to-one teaching. You are working with him from one-to-one, wide exposure to the hepatic surgery. We even wrote an editorial at that time, Hepatic Resections, the Changing Scene. Because that was a time when we were trying to look at the liver surgery, how it really changed. But the main change came with the live workshops in 1997. They were organized by Professor Jagannath and Dr. Mathur, the Tata Hospital and Nair Hospital. And that time, all Dr. Nimura, Dr. Nagi Habib, Dr. Darais Mirza, if he's there now in the camp, in this audience, they showed that live surgery. And I think that was astonishing. Everybody was spellbound. I remember people waiting in the hall up to 3 o'clock just to see what surgery was going on in the morning. It was a mesmerizing experience. First time complex liver resections were shown live in India. I think that changed the mind of people, saying that, yes, there is something which we can do it, otherwise we used to leave these patients and let them die. Over a period of 1990 to today, what really helped? Rapid advance in the diagnostic procedures, CT MRI came, accurate diagnosis, lot of collaboration from endoscopists, radiologists and gastroenterologists. Laparoscopy came in a big way, and successful liver and pancreatic transplantation. All this changed the scene of HPB surgery. And on this brink, the IHPB really arrived. And that was a time when IHPB was a new kind of an association which was built. It had an international linking. And that time also it was questioned, do you really need an IHPBA? But the question there was, do you really need to specialize into that small area, which is today no more small because every gastroenterology, surgical gastroenterologies has more than 50% of work which is hepatopancreatic biliary. Then came, we had, presidents, Dr. Shrikhande, Dr. Rangabasham, Dr. Mathur, Dr. Jagannath, Dr. Joshi, and I'm sure the series of presidents, and now the new president, Dr. Shrikhande, the Shailesh Shrikhande, who is incoming, I'm sure they gave a lot of work and they brought the IHPBA to a level. And the maximum work was done by the secretaries, especially Dr. Sitaram, Dr. Sadiq, and now Yadav, who really put in a lot of their heart to really see that how this really takes place. Now, the main changing point was World Congress of Surgery. Now, I think that was one point where we said, yes, we can do it. It was a landmark conference, 1,600 delegates, 64 countries, people from 64 countries, and 2,207 leaders of HPB. One of the most excellent program, academics, discussions, great hospitality. Everybody remembers this conference today, but that brought a lot of change in our mind of doing an HPB surgery. Now that resulted into two or three things. HPB courses came up in the way, CME started, and the MCH program started coming up. So the one of the further thing about a World Congress was an HPB course which was started by Dr. Shastri. The first course in NIMS in 2009, academic institution, interactive sessions, multi-speciality, a small group. And that was so successful, 6 days. People really said, yes, this is where I can learn. Now I am getting little more understanding of these particular diseases. So therefore, from conferences to courses, the practices started changing. From certifications, we went to the fellowships and to the degrees. There was an impact on subspecialty, development of HPB units. And from global to local, one of the great advantage of IHPBA was, it was linked with the international section. It gave a lot of visibility to our people into the international level, and it got a lot of international wisdom to our country. I think this is something which is majorly which we realize we did in that. And also along with that, we improved technology and understanding. Now, if you really look, we were one small thing, and today we have so many kind of chapters of IHPBA, and we are all linked together, exchanging kind of an academics, and we are helping us to really grow. Now there are 31 national chapters. I think I must really put name of here, Dr. Jagannath. From World Congress to World President, he put India onto the world map, especially in the HPB surgery. And that was something which I thought was one of the leader, how much he can really do. We started getting awards at the international conferences. I'm sure Dr. Senthil Nathan, our laparoscopic surgeon, won first prize at APHPBA. And it was the news. We started getting appreciations at IHPBA in the world congresses. And the think tank of the IHPBA International, that was the time thought, yes, we must have an HPB curriculum. We must have an education and training committee. We must have balancing uniformity and flexibility to optimize creativity. And from there, now the thought process is that we have to go from a sporadic learning from one-to-one to a certified learning and formalized kind of a learning. So the progress now has to go a form of sporadic learning to certified learning. So the HPB curriculum came in India. I think the HPB curriculum started in 2010, first MCH HPB surgery. Limited center, five centers, seats 13. Fellowships in HPB surgeries came at university level. And I'm sure as an association, Dr. Sudeep was talking to me, as an association, we can take a little more log books and do it much more sincerely. Structured curriculum and specialized centers, because this experience is very varied. And be exposed to all subspecialities in the HPB surgery. Medical Council finalized curriculum in 2015. There were a lot of other outcomes. We had excellent centers of development, better books, better research designs, and more publications which started coming from India. I'm just going to show some pictures, but what main changes which have really come? We had a lot of clinical practice and performance leaders. They are the people who run leaders, Adarsh, Ramesh, Jagannath, GV, Nandi sir, all these people are running clinical centers. We have now lot of education and academic centers. Shastri, Sadiq, I'm sure I can go on taking names. Transplant centers have come up in a big way. Laparoscopy, I'm sure we have shown the way how to do laparoscopic Whipples. And researcher has been come, especially lot of research has come from our country now, which is contextual, but we need to do more. So because of this increase in academic programs, the things like laparoscopic liver resection now is commonly done in India, though at limited centers. 12 CME programs in small town, especially Dr. Rupesh Mehta and Dr. Khandelwal took this to the small towns. IHPB training courses now are done twice a year. Now we have cadaver travel programs, and now we are doing increased complex HPB surgery training. I think this is a change which came from over last 30 years, and we now have to see what is next. Because we have come this way, and we have now tried to look at, see, look at our lab HPB papers, our Indian section, as well as if you look at the world congresses, the number of papers which were presented have gone up. This is an absolutely an objective way of looking at it, how people are really working. So now is the time to look behind and say, how are you going to look at this impact, and what is the next phase we want to really go through? Now, if you really look at the impact of all this, we have to look at various factors. What changed clinical practice? What changed education? What are consensus guidelines? What is the need for HPB units and research? Now, HPB surgery as a specialty, you must realize any specialty, when the concepts become clear, there is an increase in confidence of people. When the technology is available, the techniques become safer. When the techniques become safer, the indications expand. And when the indications expand, benefit to the community is more. So from concepts to indications expanding, the community benefit is very high. Having said that, I would like to say here that disease should not be adopted to a technique, but technique to a disease. Many times we see that I have learned a technique, now I am going to adopt all diseases to that. We should not really try to do that. We should try to really see that I would see which technique is best for that particular disease. Now look at the surgery trends across the world. The number of blood transfusions have gone down drastically. The blood loss at surgeries for liver, which was once on time a nightmare, you remember as a junior houseman, we used to always run to the blood banks. Now we don't do it very often. The hospital stay have gone down, morbidity has gone down, mortality of the liver surgery has gone down. Pancreatic and biliary surgery is now done all over. Liver surgery in select centers and complex HP surgery is available. Transplant surgeon programs are picking up, and laparoscopic surgery is increasing over years. Now look at this paper which was published sometime in 2007 by Nandi sir and his group. Mortality 6.6% for hepatic resection, and I'm sure it will be now lower. There's a great leap in the liver transplant surgery and large volume transplant units with acceptable rates, but mainly into LDLT. Now last year we at Asia Pacific level really looked at the impact of certification. Now look at a country like Japan. They have a clinical database. What they did, they looked at all people who have formally certified into HPB and those who are not certified, and looked at their performance over next 3 or 4 years and saw, do they perform really well? And what were the limitations? What were the factors? Because if you have certified somebody, does he go into the community and does he perform really well? Because that is what we have to look as an impact certification. Now many of us do not have a national clinical database, therefore we find such data very difficult for us to get. But this is where the Japan did. Now what they found, that there is a standardization of a technique, there is a positive impact on the fellows, and there is something called as a privileging of a surgeon who gets better confidence. They did a lot of studies and they found out that certified versus non-certified, the mortality of more than one segment hepatectomy and pancreatodiadenectomy was much less, the p significant value, and this was a paper which was published last about 6 months ago. If they look at the kind of mortality of a pancreatic surgery, 30-day mortality, 90-day mortality was also less between the certified and non-certified. They also found one interesting finding. And what was that finding? They found that those people who work, go and back work in a teaching institute versus they don't work in a teaching institute, they have a difference in their mortality and the exams. And then they realize, why does this happen? Is it because of the environment? It is because of the people around you. It is because of the understanding of the disease. And all this really came up in a big way. Let us also look at the another aspect which Dutch people did. Dutch audit for the Dutch pancreatic cancer audit is a very well-known audit. It started in 2013 and the paper was published in May 2017. It was a prospective study. It was a nationwide prospective audit of pancreatic surgery. And what did they really do? They looked at 18 centers and they looked at what was the morbidity and mortality of a pancreatic duodenectomy. And what did they realize? 18 hospitals in Netherlands, about more than 1300 surgeries, overall mortality was 4.1. The range was 1.6 to 6.5%. Morbidity of clavian and endo was still very high, 29.9. Overall morbidity was 58.8%. But the morbidity in clavian and endo classification 3 was 29.9. What is the situation in other countries when it is reported? Look at Italy has reported 5.7, Belgium 8.1, England 8.4, Korea 2.1, and Japan is 3.5. I'm sure these figures run around 3 to 5%, 8% and may change from center to center. But what is important is that we have to understand one lesson, that we have brought down control onto the mortality, but we are still having a high morbidity. And let's look at why this is and how do you really tackle this over a period of time. Now look at Tata Memorial experience. I think Dr. Shrikhande's experience and his papers are amazing. If you really look over years from 1992 to 2016, look at his morbidity has gone down. His mortality is now accepted by any world figure. And I think this is a center where we have now excellent centers who do now world accepted kind of work. Now, if you look at multicentric paper which was published for all pancreas, 7 centers from pancreatic duodenectomy. I won't name the centers, but they are very high working centers. 713 cases, 12% pancreatic fistula, the range of morbidity was 6 to 38%, mortality was 3.57, the range was 2 to 5%. Now, these are best center results. What about others? We don't have data. Maybe they are much higher. And that is what we have to really look into, this morbidity issue. So now we want to take HPV surgery further into non-metro cities and non-teaching institutions. We are still struggling with the safe cholecystectomy program. The passionate Dr. Sadiq and Dr. Kapoora still want to push, and I feel that is the most important program we should push. The safe cholecystectomy program is one of the most important programs for HPV also. PD mortality is fairly stabilized, but morbidity is still high. That's the lesson. So I remember one sentence from Atul Gawande. You know, Atul Gawande is a very well-known is a US writer. And I was very fortunate that he came and worked with us for 15 days in KM. And now he's a close friend. He wrote once, there are two primary reasons why people fail. One is ignorance. That means people don't know, the knowledge is expanding, and I'm not able to really know each paper and each finding. Very few people have it on their tips, but I may not know as a practicing surgeon. But most important is inaptitude. And what is inaptitude? It is meaning the knowledge exists, but an individual or group of individuals fail to apply knowledge correctly in that particular situation. And this we see every day in our clinical situation. When you look back, realize that this was there, but I did not really apply it properly. And this is what we call it as a clinical reasoning. So failure to rescue at a particular time is a concept which was really developed. We miss more by not seeing rather than by not knowing. That means it doesn't come to our mind, that clinical reasoning. Are we also facing the issue of FTR and rescue support in our country? Recently, there was a paper in Chirurgia 2017, failure to rescue and rescue teams. I think it is one concept that if you want to improve the quality of any program, failure to rescue is one of the criteria, how many I missed and how many I could have really improved. And this becomes now criteria of failure to rescue. Should become a standard of quality improvement. Preparedness for rescue surgery is the main pillar in this process. So factors that influence FTR in palliative radiotectomy and biliary injury is teaching hospitals, high hospital technology, increased nurse to patient ratio, more than 20 ICU beds. These are some factors of a microsystem. But I'm sure if you analyze every hospital, there could be many different factors. So reducing morbidity, if you want to do, when you want to take now surgery into the further, we need to have early recognition and management is the key to reducing morbidity and mortality. Standardization of the procedures at all stages. And we need to develop as teams of interventionalists, diagnostics and laboratory. Now suspecting post-operative pancreatic leak when to order a CT scan becomes always a question. If you do it too early, many times you not pick up. If you do too late, probably the complication is already gone up. Many times, these are the questions which we have to see, how do we reduce FTR and morbidity. So if you now want to take HPV surgery further, what do we really need? We need a competency-driven education. We need standardization of processes and procedures. We need consensus guidelines, which are contextual to us. We need credentialing and privileging of surgeons. And what we need is the mentorship programs. Now, if you see, competency is a word which is very commonly used. And I think today I am working for the whole country about competency-based education at UG and PG education. And it's a bigger challenge in our country to how to bring competency. Now, somebody who develops in his career, he has a way of developing. In a first phase of life, he would develop in an early novice. He's motivated, focused. Then in a second phase, he becomes critical thinker and continuous learner. And as he becomes practitioner, he becomes a self-improved and he gets creative solutions for the situation. Now, when in a residency, we are in the first three or four phases, and then you go as an expert, you would like to really go into that particular phase. So most of us may be at this stage, how to go into that stage, and that is what a question which you want to do. So once somebody looks at the competency ladder as a teacher, you know, these are the standard unconscious competence, incompetence to conscious incompetence to cautious competence to unconscious competence. It's like driving. We normally begin, when we are not driving, we don't know what we don't need. When we start driving, we realize we are conscious about our incompetence. The first few days, we are consciously trying to drive, but after some time, we never realize where we are in the third gear. But as a teacher, we have to understand that there's a conscious competence of unconscious competence is most important, that is called as a level 5. We should be able to recognize our people where they are lacking and how to improve, because we work in teams. And if you don't get that fifth sense, we will failure to rescue. And that is the cause of morbidity, which really becomes. Now, this concept was realized by all over the world. It's not that you and me realize this. So, in 2000, ACGME, that is the American College and CanMeds, introduced a concept of 5 or 6 competencies. And over 10 years, they tried to implement it across the world. But they realized that they could not do it, and the competency never accepted. So, develop what is called as a milestone network. And milestone network is nothing but a conceptual framework where you know how the residents or a physician really walks through to become an expert in that particular field. So they develop for every competency, level 1, level 2, level 3, level 4 and level 5. And then you have to see, and then some of the colleges, postgraduate programs in our country are now following this. Professor Ananta Krishnan really followed this for the last 3 years. And what he told me, Avinash, when I look at this, I see that most of my residents, I want them at level 4. I don't expect them to be level 5. But for a surgery like Whipple's, I'm happy with even level 3. They aspire as a safe surgeon. So you should be able to know where my residents, where my people are at what level, and how I really bring it down. And that's most important for anyone. So that came the concept of a European concept of entrustable professional activity. You combine all these milestones to develop a professional ability, and that is what is most important aspect of any competence. So when somebody progresses, he progresses from rigid thoughts to flexible thoughts, as most of us have progressed, from personality which was cautious, shy, to become an inventive, energetic, and emotional intelligence which is very low, we become high. And that's the transformation which all of us would like to have. Now, if you analyze every resident, every surgeon, and you put him on a plan of a competency, you will find that everybody is not on the same page. Some of them will be like this, some of them will be like this. Every area, you are not the master. Some areas you are the master, some areas you are better, some areas you are weak. But unless you plan, you don't know which areas you want to strengthen. And then many times we have egos, we have hubris. We don't want to really change and we continue to remain unexplored and in that particular level of competency before going higher up. So if you want to improve the quality of HPB education in competency-driven education, we need to think about how we can people use the knowledge well. And then we have to see how they would use technology well. So clinical reasoning is something which is not so easy to gain. You know that tomato is a fruit is a knowledge, but not to use it in a fruit salad is a wisdom. Now to get that wisdom, it takes time. And so when people start talking about clinical reasoning, one of my teacher, you know, Bordaj, he was a medical education editorial board chairman for 20 years and is still there. He gave the whole concept of clinical reasoning. And he said clinical reasoning is the way you organize knowledge in your mind. You know, there are so many people, I really appreciate Ramesh Ardhanari, the way he was really reasoning out, and that is what we really want to have. So if you really look at the knowledge and the context, if you have a low knowledge and low context, it's a reduced kind of a clinical reasoning. The person present facts but minimal diagnostic information cannot make links between the knowledge is low. The first year resident is a classic example of this. He has knowledge, he has read it from Google. Sometimes he does not have knowledge. The third year resident has a knowledge which is dispersed, but he is not able to still make a contents. Abundant knowledge without awareness of context and capacity of application. That when he becomes a lecturer, his knowledge is good, context is good, the expert has access to extensive case knowledge, but this knowledge remains encapsulated until he needed. All of us have lecturers what we are today, and as you become expert, how you change? But what we need is a compiled knowledge. So it's a high evolved knowledge and high context. Immediately recognize patterns, synthesize the clinical data into highly abstract and compiled terms. And this is what we need to do. So is there a way of people training people? Yes, there are many ways people do it. There's a 1 minute preceptor way of doing it. There are SNAPS model. There are various ways of clinical teaching, which I won't go into details, but now they're available and we need to adopt them. There's something called as a clinical decision making. You know, this was something which we never really use it. Training in a clinical thinking and social skills and timely feedback. You know, today what has happened, the students start competing from 8th standard till they become super specialist. About 15 to 20 years are channelized to get CETs, marks and degrees. They have no lateral thinking. The student gets strategized. He doesn't have that lateral thinking which is needed for a clinical decision making. So I remembered I undertook a course in clinical decision making just by a psychologist was when I was doing my master's. And I realized that so many gaps in our clinical decision making. In fact, clinical decision making now is a science. There are journals who come out, there are books on this, but we as a community hardly look into these kind of aspects of our development. Now the next thing is simulation and cadaveric workshops. Now this is our strength of our country. Cadaveric workshops were conducted in PhD for the first time, I think Dr. Nagral conducted. Then there are, in fact, our own, we had laparoscopic liver surgery, cath lab. And if you recently look at the review which came into surgical laparoscopic, dedicated cadaveric liver labs facility will not only is an excellent method to train. And this is where people are now going towards the cadaveric lab. The third thing is technology enhanced learning. You know, we can talk about this n number of times, but we have to remember that 3D models, people have started working. Now we have a 3D printing model of a liver, you have a 3D model of a pancreas for anastomosis and practicing to improve your skills and take you from, say, level 2 to level 4 very easily. Simulated 3D printing models. You know, one of the classic way in Japanese they train is today that they would have somebody who is operating actually and somebody is working on a simulated model of 3D which is as good as a patient. And there was a recent paper which came in last month, December 17, and it says that 3D printing man in liver surgery is a systematic review
and they said models are considered useful in preoperative planning and patient-student education. High cost and time-consuming process, and it has promising early results. 3D printing is now available in India. It is available in a poor hospital like mine, KM Hospital. Neurosurgeons and orthopedics have started using it. But over a period of time, it will come to the HPB surgery. Maybe after a few years, our students will learn on 3D printing model. We can start using them in complex cases. The second thing what we need is a standardization of processes and procedures. Why do we really need this? Now, I'm sure everybody has read a book by Atul Gawande on checklist. And everybody said that we'll give a checklist and the patient will be all right. But he gave a wonderful talk last year in anesthesia conference. He said, instead of checklist, we should start talking about outcomes. And he said the standardizing part of the complex surgical procedures make the surgery safer, more efficient and effective treatment modality. There are additional benefits of standardization, include shorter operating time due to everybody's tuned to the whole thing. Whether, I'm sure we had so many years debate about PG versus PJ. Over a period of time, it settled that every person should standardize and get expertise. The person who is comfortable with PJ is very happy with PJ, the same results. Somebody is with PG, he's continued with the PG. But we have spent days together in the conferences to realize that standardization is a better solution rather than this. So, there was a very nice paper which came in Annals of Surgery. And the paper said, taking a chance of playing it safe, reframing the risk assessment with the surgeon's comfort zone. Every surgeon at a comfort zone with some kind of a framing, risk. So, what we really need to do is reframe and stratify our risk. In your own unit, you realize that what risk I am ready to take, what risk I am ready to give it to my residents, what risk I should refer. And if you are in that comfort zone, then automatically you standardize the procedure and you work with that standardization. Seniors can work with a high risk and you will find your results will improve. So, suspecting a postoperative leak, you could have a standardized protocol and you can really order CT scan, but a standard protocol should be beneficial to the patients and not to the hospitals. Many times people go on doing CTs alternate days, go on doing all investigations which increases the bills, but see that standard protocol when you're planning should be beneficial to the patients and that risk adjustment has to be done. The third thing we have to do is a consensus guidelines. Evidence is not available for every process and procedure. Look at the controversies we had 2 hours before, every talk we are talking about controversies, probably we had no answers. Because everybody has his own thought processes. Now when we say evidence is not there, consensus guidelines not only guide physicians but also help in community and courts. Now Tokyo guideline was a great experience for me. We started working on Tokyo guidelines in 2007 when people asked, do you really need guidelines for acute cholecystitis and acute cholangitis? But then they were published. There were a lot of comments on this. 2013 there was another version. And 2018 now we have 10 publications which have come out. And they are made by one of the world leaders. You know, it was really fun working with people like Steve Strasberg and practically every president of IHPB and every leader in the country, in the world. And talk about simple things like what would you do at the time of cholecystectomy. In fact, we published a paper which you should all read. It's called as a Delphi Consensus on Bile Duct Injuries during laparoscopy. What, when to really stop and when to really go ahead. And Tokyo guidelines would definitely give you a. So guidelines have a lot of role in controversies. So if you really look, they would really tell you patterns of misidentification where structure one was misrecognized as structure two by whom. So, when to stop, where to stop, how to prevent injury, and what are alternatives? Fools say that they learn from experience, prefer to learn from the experience of others. And that's what the consensus guidelines are. So, once you know that we as an association have to develop some consensus guidelines on areas where we think are our problems, and where we need kind of a guidelines. And why do we really need this? This is because, look at the Calcutta case. I don't know how many of you really read that judgment. I think I remember a phone call from Sadiq one morning saying that we must do something. And yes, if you go through that judgment, it's a case where somebody has done a laparoscopic cholecystectomy, has put clips. After 5 or 6 years, that clips have slipped into CBD. He has done a ERCP and removed that stone, compared that clip, and he has been asked to pay 4.5 lakhs. Now, putting clips in a laparoscopic cholecystectomy is a very routine practice which is done by Indians today. Now, the courts, with some kind of a one publication or two publication, is going to question your integrity, is going to question your practice, and we have no support to really say from India that yes, this is a practice which is done by all hundreds. Do we have consensus guidelines? We do not have. So how do we really stand in the court and defend ourselves? Because prompted us to think about these newer procedures, we left and right try to do innovations. We must prove to the society that we have credentials. And training institutions and regulatory bodies have a role to play and privilege a surgeon to perform procedure as per the SOP and to accept quality. So we need to create evidence of training, evidence of competence, record training and achievement competence, record complex and equivalent procedures. Courts will ask us in next few days or few years. May not you now, but courts will ask us. Associations and regulatory bodies will have to develop system more so with new procedures. Is it only our problem? No, all over the world. Look at the SAGES guidelines which are published in 2017. It says informal familiarization of the device, review of the existing data. It's worth going through these guidelines and practice on cadavers. But most important, they said that proctored initial cases, teleproctoring of initial cases, and team training. If you do that, probably you will be able to go through this kind of a ritual. So that brings me to the last point of mentorship. Now, does seeing a live workshop or 1 week course really improve the skill and confidence of a surgeon to do a new procedure? I have my doubt about myself. All of us who say that I was mesmerized by this, yes, fine, it's okay. But am I able to convert that into my practice? And that is the question we have to ask. You know, all of us read Mahabharata. Look at Arjun. Arjun had all kinds of training. He had short-term training, long-term fellowship, he went to other place, he did all kinds of training. But when it came to the point of fighting, he could not do, he lost his confidence, and he needed a mentor. And that was Krishna. And this is a story, but we never look that story from that point of view. So that is the role of a mentor. Mentor let you really perform within the system with all kinds of things. So mentorship programs are extremely important. So we need one-to-one or institutional mentorships to take this forward. Telementoring or actual mentoring is now possible through technology. I'm sure adopt a non-teaching institute. We have wonderful HPB units today, and I will talk about it. My HPB, Lab Guru, Google Glass, now the technology is going one step ahead. My HPB or IHPBA is a wonderful kind of initiative, lot of videos, lot of discussions. We had a surgical gastroenterology group. Lot of people talked and shared that wisdom, shared those kind of experiences, and that is where we would really progress further. In fact, teleclinics, which are started by Pradeep and the whole team, I must really congratulate Pradeep for the GI surgery clinics. Excellent initiative. There are 7 or 8 centers on Monday morning really discuss. I invite you, many of you, if you want to come in to KEM, you can really be there. There's a follow-up discussion, shared articles, and combined wisdom. The same can be translated to various kinds of clinical kind of wisdom sharing. Developing HB units is very important. Talent win matches, teams win championships. We are surgeons. We are always self-centric, I'm sure, as the way our image is. But for HPB surgery, we need teams. Predominantly HPB work, adequate infrastructure and institutional support, skilled team and support, trained anesthesiologist in liver, and ICU lab diagnostic. We have examples of wonderful centers who have been doing. If I missed one name, I'm thinking, pardon me, but we have excellent teams who are working as HPB units. I request them that at least adopt one non-teaching institute, hold their hand to take forward this mentorship program. Now, why do you want to mentor? Because today, we do not have one unit providing everything to our HPB program. The benign HPB is separating out. You know, in this world of HPB oncology, sometimes I feel a simple cholecystectomy is really backing out. We need to work also on that difficult cholecystectomy. HPV malignancy is one, transplantation is one, mass is one. So we need to have lot of collaboration, exchange programs, and that would probably bring a lot of mentorship programs to grow ahead. So fellowship concept in the developing world, we need sandwich fellowships. Most of our fellows want to work abroad and want to come back and also see how it works in my country. And he has to have a teleproctoring going on. Fellow completes fellowship in a developed world as well as at home, increases home institution capacity, and assured quality training with the teleproctoring. Most important thing is, whenever you have a program, involve people into academic scholarship. Academic scholarship today is a concept all over the world where you would like to have not only publications but an academic analysis of the whole thing. Engage education related dialogue, contribute to the journals and books, attend seminars, present in education seminars and professional development workshops. Even a simple attitude development workshop would change your clinical performance. We also need a contextual research. Clinical research and reporting has definitely increased in India, or whatever else does. Now we have to question about the quality. When a research evidence matches clinical experience, it is most powerful. We need to promote contextual research. I think the classic paper which Jagannath and Chiranjeev really published from the rural gangetic basin needs to be explored more. Chronic heavy metal exposure of gallbladder cancer risk. These are the kind of papers we need to really publish. To end with, the journey at KEM has been always a pleasant journey. In our institution, they did first liver transplant in 1968. That was the time we were not in medical college, but we only heard about it. With Dr. Bhale Rao and Dr. Mathur, we continued to work on hepatic surgery, pancreatic surgery. It was exposure to us. Regular liver and Whipple's operation started, resections from 1986. Extensive portal hypertension surgery. I think if you really see, Dr. Mathur did DVASC, shunts. My own team does now a lot of shunts. First national workshop on lap cholecystectomy. When we did our first lap appendicectomy, somebody wrote letter saying that we are doing unethical things. When we started doing lap cholecystectomy, no unit head supported me. I was the only unit head and I could only take every whole risk in my unit and do that. I never knew that time what the risk was, but we took it and we progressed. We had a separate department in 2003. And we now progress to the one of the state-of-the-art department with the technology. So this is my team, very small team, Chetan, Prabhu. 25 plus laparoscopic workshops we conducted to mentor small city programs, surgeons. In fact, that was an experience where we took surgeons from small cities in Maharashtra and trained them, including their nurses and their assistants. And we saw tremendous effect of those in our country, which was going. Well-equipped modular OT and state-of-the-art equipment, a complex HPB surgery program, 300 per year, including cholecystectomies, for last 8 years. But what is most important that we now do liver transplants, and last year we did about 4 or 5 liver transplants, affordable cost of 3 to 4 lakhs, and that were cadaveric liver transplants. Now, this is a model, I'm sure, for a public hospital, but of course the private sector can really handhold some of the other semi-private. Now, what is more satisfying is the KEM students now across the world leading HPB and transplant programs. What came out in 90s, today I am very proud to say that whether it's Atlanta, whether it's Singapore, whether it is Dr. Darius or everywhere, our students now lead HPB programs in UK, USA, Singapore and Europe. And that is something which we feel very happy about it as an investment. So when we think about transformation beyond change, developing and dedicated HPB units, adopting and institutions, sharing and exchange faculty and doing a mentorship programs, expansion of the HPB practice in second level cities, doing a performance audit of what we are doing, that will probably improve the quality of care and that will improve the HPB surgery. As Dr. Jagannath says, there is always a tipping point. We all did it. You and me sitting in this crowd have brought this IHPB and HPB surgery in India to this situation. We pushed that stone across to the hill. But now IHPB has crossed that tipping point. And now it is going to go. So now we have to think about how we will take this care and quality into the system. The tipping point is a magic moment when an idea and trend and social behavior crosses a threshold. I would like to acknowledge all the presidents, secretaries, my all mentors, Dr. Jagannath, Dr. Mathur, Dr. Shrikhande, GI surgery, my own team, Chetan, Prabhu, Sharwari, Bhushan, all my residents is my maximum kind of support. And Dr. Badve and Dr. Shailesh who really helped me to make this presentation. Now, when you think about transformation beyond change, I would like to end in Marathi, and I would मी तुमची क्षमा मागतो की मी मराठीत बोलणार आहे. विद्येचे माहेरघर असणाऱ्या पुण्य नगरीत डॉक्टर जोशींसारख्या कर्तव्यदक्ष आणि कर्तृत्ववान शल्यशास्त्रज्ञांमुळे प्रेरित झालेले व्याख्यान देणं म्हणजे महत्भाग्य. तो मान आपण सर्वांनी मला दिला याबद्दल मी आपले मनापासून आभार मानतो. शेवटी माझ्या तरुण इसले असलेल्या सगळ्या मित्रांना मी एकच सांगू शकतो की कुसुमाग्रजांच्या ओळी आहेत, देखणे जे हात त्यांना निर्मितीचे डोहळे. काहीतरी नवीन निर्माण करा. अनंत मुची ध्येयासक्ती, अनंत मुची आशा, किनारा तुला पामराला. आपण सर्व खूप ॲम्बिशियस आहोत, आपण खूप अचीव करायचा प्रयत्न करतो. तुमच्या उत्साहाला किनारा नाही. तुमच्या पंखात गरुड भरारीचे बळ येऊ देत मोठे व्हा, पण आपल्या मातृभूमीला आणि आपल्या इन्स्टिट्यूटला विसरू नका. तिला यशाच्या शिखरावर बसवा. आम्हा सर्वांचे आशीर्वाद तुमच्या पाठीशी आहेत. धन्यवाद.
Yeah, I request Dr. Juvi Rao to thank the orator.
Thank you so much, Avinash. This year, when the executive committee sat down to decide on the orator for this MJ oration, one name that came was Avinash. And today, you know the importance of this oration and the content of this oration. I, on behalf of the entire executive committee, the members of IHPBA, profoundly thank Avinash for this awesome oration that is delivered, brought in to the light of what all has happened in IHPBA in the last few years in the inception. And it would be a lesson to all the juniors here to learn and to know what all has happened in IHPBA all these years, and who are all the leaders who have brought this to this stage. Thank you so much, Avinash, for this, and I think he deserves a standing ovation for this. Thank you so much for this.
I request Professor Avinash Supe and the other dignitaries or present on the dais to move to the center of the stage for felicitation. Orator and the dignitaries, President, Secretary of the Association and President-elect. The oration function is officially over. And it's a lunch time, but there is also a lunch symposium sponsored by Olympics. Those who want to attend, please come forward so that the hotel persons, they can start dividing the hall. So those who are sitting behind, please come forward. And I call upon Dr. Roy Patankar to come on the stage and start the proceedings. This symposium is sponsored by Olympics.
long time no see.